would see that the nephew of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is covered with dust, his clothes are covered with dust, his hair is covered with dust, he would say to the nephew of Rasulullah, أَلَّا بَأَسَّ إِلَيَّ حَتَّى آتِيَكَ O Ibn Abbas, only if you sent a messenger, only if you sent a message, then I would have come to you and I would have related this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to you. The nephew of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would reply, أَنَا حَقُّ وَلِأَلَيْكَ This is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Ibn Abbas, it was the right of Ibn Abbas to come to you and to take this hadith from you. The kings at the time had so much love for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the kings at the time would sit on the floor with common people to acquire this knowledge. Asim, who is one of the relatives of Bukhari, Imam Zahabi in Tazkirat al-Huffaz says that when he dictated hadith, sometimes over 100,000 people attended his hadith circles. And amongst the common people, the King Harun Rashid would be seen sitting on the floor on leaves of the palm tree writing the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not only did the king have so much love for this hadith, some of the kings were even huffaz of hadith, masters of hadith. It is reported that the king, Mamun Rashid, when he was still a child, his father sent him to the muhaddith Abdullah ibn Idris to acquire the knowledge of hadith. His teacher Abdullah ibn Idris began to relate 100 hadith. He recited 100 hadith unto him. Mamun Rashid has just heard this hadith once for the first time. After his teacher has recited these 100 hadith, Mamun Rashid says to his teacher, Ya am, ata'zan li al-u'idaha min hifzi? Oh uncle, do you allow me to recite this hadith from my memory? Mamun Rashid recited the very same 100 hadith which he himself has just heard once without a single mistake. Every single thing they possess, they sacrifice for the sake of a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yahya ibn Ma'in was a master of hadith at his time. His father was a secretary of one of the governors. It is related that his father left 1,050,000 dirhams of that time for his son Yahya ibn Ma'in, thinking that Yahya will not need to work. Yahya will live in peace and comfort and luxury. Khatib al-Baghdadi relates, فَأَنْفَقَهُ كُلَّهُ عَلَى الْحَدِيثِ حَتَّى لَمْ يَبْقَ لَهُ نَعْلٌ يَلْبِسُ That Yahya ibn Ma'in spent 1,050,000 dirhams of that time, every single penny for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, on hadith to the extent that this person who has inherited so much, 1,050,000, a time has come when Yahya ibn Ma'in is walking on the streets barefooted because Yahya ibn Ma'in has no slippers to wear. Isa ibn Yunus was a master of hadith at his time. It is related that for three generations, Huffaz of Hadith, masters of Hadith were born in his family. The wazir of Harun Rashid, Ja'far, came to him and offered 100,000 dirhams to him. Isa ibn Yunus refused and said, Isa ibn Yunus cannot live with this guilt that he took a penny in exchange for the Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the first factor which helped to preserve the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not only did they sacrifice each and everything they possessed for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when they acquired this blessed knowledge, they were very careful in relating the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Knowing that our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, مَنْ كَذَبَ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّ مَقَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ Whoever attributes a lie to me, then he should take his place in the fire of hell. The muhaddithin, the masters of a hadith, were very, very careful in relating the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is related that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, when he related the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he mentioned the beloved name of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the words are, وَارْتَعَدَ Abdullah ibn Mas'ud would begin to tremble, وَارْتَعَدَ الثِّيَابُ Thus his clothes would begin to shake, تَنْفُقُ أَوْدَادُ His veins would swell, وَغْرَوْرَتْ عَيْنَاهُ And his eyes would be full of tears. Such was the state of Abu Huraira, that Shufayya narrates, he visited Medina al-Munawwara. فَإِذَنْ هُوَ بِرَجُلٍ كَذِ اجْتَمَعَ النَّاسُ عَلَيْهِ He saw a man whom around many men have gathered. He asked, who is this person? They told him this is Abu Huraira. He says, فَدَنَوْتُ مِنْ حَتَّى قَالْتُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَهُوَ يُحَدِّثُ النَّاسِ I walked and sat in front of him. He was reciting the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Huraira was teaching the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, when he was all alone, when there was nobody around, I asked Abu Huraira, Abu Huraira narrated me a hadith which you directly heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which you thoroughly know and understood. Abu Huraira said to him, لَوْ حَدِّثَنَّكَ حَدِيثًا حَدَّثَنِيهَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَقَلْتُ وَعَلِمْتُ that I will definitely relate you a hadith which Abu Huraira directly heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which Abu Huraira thoroughly knows and understands. The narrator says Abu Huraira was on the verge of relating this hadith when all of a sudden Abu Huraira heaved a sigh and Abu Huraira fainted. فَمَكَثْنَا قَلِيلًا. He says we waited for a short while till Abu Huraira gained conscious. When he was fully conscious, he said for the second time that I will definitely relate a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to you, which I heard directly from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this very house when there was nobody inside this house besides me and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The narrator says for the second time Abu Huraira heaved a sigh and Abu Huraira fainted. Abu Huraira wasn't able to relate the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet again we waited for a short while, Abu Huraira gained conscious, he mocked his face, and for a third time Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, لَوْ حَدِّثَنَّكَ حَدِيثًا حَدَّثَنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَقَلْتُهُ وَعَلِمْتُ. Then I will definitely relate a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with Abu Huraira directly heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this very house when there was nobody inside the house besides Abu Huraira and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The narrator says for a third time Abu Huraira was on the verge of narrating the hadith when yet again Abu Huraira heaved a sigh, Abu Huraira fainted. This time he was inclining toward one side, Abu Huraira was on the verge of falling flat on his face. He said, I held and supported Abu Huraira. I kept him supporting him for a long time till finally Abu Huraira gained conscience and finally Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated a hadith. They would keep on fainting because they feared كَمَنْ كَذَبَ عَلَيَّ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّأْ مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. That whoever relates, whoever attributes a lie to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then his, that he should take his place in the fire of hell. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu to teach the other Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in a lesson in being very careful with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now and then he would ask the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in for proof before he accepted their narration. It is related that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu once visited Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh from behind the door 3 times. On hearing no reply, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari returned. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu sent a message calling him. When he came, he asked, Lima raja? Abu Musa, tell me why you returned. Abu Musa related the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِذَا سَلَّمَ أَحَدَكُمْ ثَلَاثًا فَلَمْ يُجَبْ فَلْيَرْجِعْ. That one of you have said salam 3 times and there is no answer, then he should return. As Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to him, كَلَتَأْتِيَنِّي عَلَى ذَلِكَ بَيِّنَةً أَوْ لَا فَعَلَى النَّبِكَ. Abu Musa, you better prove it to me or I, Umar, will punish you. Abu Musa al-Ashri radiallahu ta'ala anhu returned to his companions. His companions, seeing that his face had turned pale, they asked him, what's the matter? He related the incident and they said, do not worry, as we have all heard this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said to Hazrat Abu Musa al-Ashri, أَمَا إِنِّي لَمَا أَجْتَحِنْكَ لَكِنَّهُ الْحَدِيثَ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Musa, it is not that I didn't trust you or I thought you were lying, but it's a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Umar is very careful and cautious when it comes to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the first factor which helped to preserve the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The love the Sahaba and their successors had for the sunnah, for the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they sacrificed each and everything they possessed to acquire this blessed knowledge. The second factor which helped to preserve the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were the teaching methods used by our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to teach his sunnah. I'm sure you will agree, no matter how clever a teacher is, if the teacher does not know how to teach, if he does not know how to get a message across, then students cannot benefit from such a teacher. And if the students have not understood what the teacher has said, then it is virtually impossible to remember his teachings. Never mind preserve these teachings for years to come. Our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the best of all teachers, as he himself was taught by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is his teaching methods that helped to preserve the sunnah. And so whoever attended the gathering of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not leave without understanding what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. Our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a very mild approach, and he was very gentle with his students. As Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates, كبينما نحن في المسجد مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذ جاء عربي فقام يبول في المسجد We were inside the masjid with our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That somebody is dirtying the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is urinating in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, began to reproach him, began to send him off. Our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, that was removed. Do not say anything to him. A person is dirtying the house of Allah, and the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the companions, do not say anything to him. Let him finish. When he finished, our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him and said to him, إِنَّ هَذِهِ الْمَسَاجِدِ لَا تَصْلَأُ لَشَيْءٍ مِنْ هَذَا الْبَوْلِ وَلَا الْكَذِرِ إِنَّمَا هِيَ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ وَالصَّلَاةِ وَقِرَاءَةِ الْقُرْآنِ. That this is the house of Allah. It is a special place. It is a very sacred place. It is a place only for certain things. It is a place to remember Allah. It is a place for salah. It is a place for worship. It is a place to recite the Qur'an. Thus, it is not permissible to dirty the house of Allah and do anything of that nature. Such, the effect of this teaching was that companions like this never forgot the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding the masajid. They never forgot whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught. Another method that our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used was that he would talk to everybody according to their level of understanding. And he would use the examples and language they understood. Abu Huraira relates كَأَنَّ رَجُلٌ مِّن بَنِي فَزَارَ جَاعِ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صلى الله عليه وسلم, that once a man from Banu Fazara came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and said, إِنَّمْ رَأَتِي وَلَدَتْ غُلَامًا أَسْوَدْ, Messenger of Allah, my wife's given birth. But the child is black. وَإِنِّي أَنْكَرْتُهُ, thus, it doesn't seem to be mine. And thus I've denied that it's my child. Subhanallah. Just listen to the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to him. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam listened. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him the question, هَلَكَ مِنْ إِبْنِ, do you have any camels? Happy that the Messenger of Allah is asking a question regarding camels, he said, yes. Oh Messenger of Allah, I have many camels. Tell me you have camels. What color are your camels? He replied, O Messenger of Allah, my camels are red. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, هَلْ فِيهَا مِنْ عَوْرَةٍ, tell me you have these beautiful red camels. Is there a dusky one amongst them? He replied, O Messenger of Allah, yes, there is a dusky one amongst them. Messenger of Allah asked, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have red camels. Where did this dusty one come from? فَأَنَّ أَتَاهَا ذَلِي, all your camels are red, yet you have one dusky one. Where did it come from? He replied, O Messenger of Allah, it is possible that down the line, one of his grandparents were of that color. This is why it is dusky. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to him, similarly, it is possible that one of the grandparents of this child down the line was also of this color. Once a young man from the Quraysh came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَنْ لِي فِي الزِّنَا, O Messenger of Allah, let me commit adultery. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala an majma'in, all present, when they heard that this person is asking the Prophet of Allah permission to commit a major sin, when the Prophet of Allah has been sent to prohibit people from committing sins, they began to send him off reproaching. Okay, what are you doing? Asking the Nabi of Allah to commit sin? Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, leave him. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him, made him sat close to him. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, أَتُحِبَّهُ لِعُمِّكْ, you've asked to commit this sin. You've asked to commit this act. If it is a good act, would you like it for your mother? He replied, La Allah, O Messenger of Allah, no, I would not like it for my mother. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, وَلَا النَّاسُ يُحِبُّونَهُ لِأُمَّهَاتِهِمْ, and how do people like it for their mothers? Tell me, if it is a good act and you want permission, أَتُحِبُّهُ لِبِنْتِكْ, would you like the same thing for your daughter? If somebody came and asked for permission for your daughter to do the same act? Yet again he replied, La Allah. He understood straight away, O Messenger of Allah, by Allah, no, I wouldn't like it for my daughter. Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا النَّاسُ يُحِبُّونَهُ لِبَنَاتِهِمْ, and nor do people like it for their daughters. Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed for him. Allahumma aghfir zamba wa tahhir kalba wa hassin farja. Oh Allah, forgive his sin.